collision detection is an important concept for video games. It can make or break your game. It can be very simple at times, or very complex. This time, we'll keep it rather simple. In my previous tutorial, we covered metasprites. In this tutorial, you'll learn how to implement tile map collision detection like you might have seen in Zelda or Pokemon. If you need help, check out the video description below for helpful links. Also, feel free to leave me a comment or send me an email. In a previous tutorial, I went over metasprites. We're going to utilize that knowledge to draw our basic player. We'll also draw a basic map that our player can collide with. With this, in future videos, I've decided to switch up the presentation. To save time and due to the increasing complexity of my topics, I won't be writing the source code from scratch in my videos. I will still explain each part of the code though. Also, in the video description, you'll be able to find a link to the source code on GitHub, which means we won't be building from the minimal template anymore. Once you download or clone the repo, update your GBDK home variable and run the makefile once. Some assets are dynamically generated from PNG to asset, which I will cover in another video. In this tutorial, we'll cover two basic cases. How to handle tile map collision with the 16x16 square, and how to handle tile map collision with a single point. In the source code, you'll find two main files, one for each of our two cases. If you run the makefile, two ROM files will be generated. Both of our resultant ROM files will be very similar. The only difference will be how the metasprite collides with the world. Let's start with handling a single point. Our main singlepoint.c file defines only a main function. At the start of that function, we'll set things up using the SetupDemo function. The other main.c file also uses this function. You can find the SetupDemo function inside of the common.c file. Our SetupDemo function does four things. It enables 8x16 sprites in the background layer. It adds our sprite and background tile data to VRAM. It draws our background tile map, and it resets the player's position to near the middle of the screen. Getting back into the main function, once everything is ready to go, we can start the game loop. For both demos, the game loop will do three things: pull for player input, check for collisions against the world in the direction the player is moving, and finally, draw the player metasprite at the proper position. Neither demo will move the player's position directly. Instead, we'll utilize two variables called nextPlayerX and nextPlayerY. At the start of our game loop, these two variables will match the player's current position. Our joypad input will change these variables depending on which D-pad buttons the player presses. All of that is done in the getPlayerInput function. You can find that function also in the common.c file. The getPlayerInput function also updates which direction the player is moving in. Back in our game loop, next, if the player isn't moving, we'll just draw our metasprite at the player's current position. If the player is moving in any direction, we'll check for collision against the world. So the player can slide against the walls, we'll handle horizontal and vertical motion separately. If the player is moving horizontally, we'll check if the next position is on a solid tile. If it isn't, we'll update the player's actual position. We'll do the exact same thing again, but for vertical motion. At the end, we'll update the player's metasprite position. To determine if the position in the world was solid, we utilized a function called worldPositionIsSolid. This function is where the math for our tile map collision detection occurs. This function ultimately checks the tile set tile at the location given to it. We first need to calculate the column and row the specified location is on top of. Given a world position, to get the column, we just divide the X position by the size of a single grid node. Note, if your grid is a multiple of two, bit shifting is way more performant. In this tutorial, our grid nodes are 8x8. For clarity, I'm going to keep the division in there for now, but bit shifting would be better in a real game situation. We can get our row similar to how we got our column, except this time we operate on the Y position. With the column, the row, and one more piece of information, we can determine our tile map index. That is, the tile in our one-dimensional tile map array that we are on. We used this same array to draw our background in the setup demo function. The final bit of information I mentioned is the width of the tile map in tiles. Once we have those three, we can find our tile map index using the following equation. We'll take that value and use it directly with the tile map array that we use to draw our background. In this demo, our tile set only has 10 total tiles, 9 of which are solid tiles. I've intentionally put all of the solid tiles at the beginning of the tile set. This is very important. It allows me to check for solidness with a single if statement. If the tile index we previously calculated is less than the number of solid tiles, we have a solid tile. If we compile and run, we'll see a basic maze and be able to move a 16 by 16 circle sprite around that maze. We can't move through walls, but there is some overlap. That's because we only handled collision detection for a single point. Next, we'll handle collision detection for a 16 by 16 square. If you go to the main.c file, you can find that logic. It's very similar to the previous file. However, it's got a couple more collision detection checks. Because our player sprite is 16 by 16, when moving horizontally or vertically, we need to check two more points on the associated edge. If we're moving to the right, we need to check the middle right point, the top right corner, and the bottom right corner. If we're moving to the left, we need to check the middle left point, the top left corner, and the bottom left corner. If we're moving downward, we need to check the bottom left corner, the bottom middle point, and the bottom right corner. If we are moving upward, we need to check the top left corner, the top middle point, and the top right corner. If our player was 8x8, we'd only need to check the corners. If our player was 24x24, we would need to check four different points on each side when moving. How many points we need to check depends on the size of the object. If we don't perform these additional checks, it's possible to get stuck in the world or overlap solid tiles. If we compile and run, we can now move the player and there is no overlap. That's it for this tutorial. You can find a link to the source code in the video description below. If you need help or have any questions, feel free to leave a comment below. If you found this video helpful, click the like button to help with the YouTube algorithm. If you like this type of content and want more, subscribe to support the channel. Thanks and have a good day.